let us discuss about the pericardium. Pericardium is a conical fibrocerous sac present in front of the 5 to 8 thoracic vertebra and behind the sternum and second costal cartilage, behind the sternum and the second, between the second to sixth costal cartilage, whereas in front of the 5th to 8th thoracic vertebra, and its location is in the middle mediastinum, and it is a middle mediastinum contents are, like you know, it is having heart and it's accompanied by the pericardium and the, its main great vessels coming from the heart. And if you observe this pericardium, it is having two components, the fibrous layer and the serous layer, or fibrous sac and the serous sac. So the fibrous sac, the heart is present within the fibrous sac, that means fibrous pericardium, whereas outside the serous pericardium, that means intrafibrous and the extraserous heart, we can say. So let us discuss about the fibrous pericardium first. So you can see this is a fibrous pericardium. We can have, it is a conical in shape, and it just like a bag which holds the heart inside, and it prevents the over distension of the heart, and it keeps the heart in position, and it has an apex and base. So apex is blends with the adventitia of the arch of aorta, and then you have the pulmonary trunk, and also continues above with the pretracheal layer of the deep cervical fascia. It is having base, so base is fused with the central tendon of the diaphragm, fused with the central tendon of the diaphragm, because they have a common developmental origin, that is septum transversum. And on the back side, it is having, it related with the esophagus, and then you have a descending aorta, and then esophagus vein, thoracic duct. These are all form the relations behind the fibrous pericardium, whereas anteriorly this fibrous pericardium is attached to the sternum through ligaments called as the superior and inferior sternopericardial ligaments. They are attached to that. So these are the attachments of the fibrous pericardium. You have relations also. Relations of the fibrous pericardium are anteriorly, you can observe this is the sternum, and in like at the sternum, at below the, just below the fourth costal cartilage, pericardium is directly contact with the body of the sternum, whereas above the fourth costal cartilage, you know that it is related to the sternum, and in between them we have the anterior margins of the lung and pleura will be related, whereas below the fourth costal cartilage, it is pericardium is directly related to the lower two pieces of the sternum, because you know that after the fourth costal cartilage on the left side, this pleura margin will be going to the lateral side, deviated to the lateral side. So we have a direct contact with the body of the sternum just below the left fourth costal cartilage. Whereas posterior relations are all the relations of the posterior mediastinum, right? You have the esophagus, then you have thoracic duct, descending aorta, esophagus with blood vessels, with its nerves, and you have esophagus vein and hemiesophagus vein, and splanchnic nerves. These are all the relations in the posterior aspect. Whereas on either side, it gives an impression on the lung, mediastinal impressions on the lung, and you have between the pleura and the pericardium, you have a nerve that is called as the phrenic nerve and the pericardiophrenic vessels. If you observe that, this is the phrenic nerve. Phrenic nerve, you cannot see here the nerve, because at outside it is covered by the mediastinal pleura, inner aspect it is covered by the pericardium, fibrous pericardium. So these are the relations anteriorly, posteriorly, and on either side, whereas inferiorly it is related on the left side, because it is the heart, is the pericardium is lies on the left side. You have a kind of relations of the left lobe of the liver, and then you have the fundus of the stomach will be related between the pericardium. You'll have these relations, lower relations of the pericardium. And this is about the fibrous pericardium. And now coming to the serous pericardium, I have cut this fibrous pericardium here. I have reflected it down so that you'll observe here, this is the serous pericardium. Serous pericardium and outer aspect is a fibrous pericardium. They both are fused together. inside is serous. This is the fibrous pericardium. Serous pericardium is it's a sac, serous sac, I have to tell. So serous sac is invaginated by the heart, primitive heart, from the posterior aspect and the roof, so that this total heart is covered by the two layers, outer parietal layer and inner visceral layer. So this is the parietal layer of the serous sac, this one, whereas visceral layer is closely attaches with the heart. So this is how, and if I put my finger, these fingers are in the pleural cavity between the parietal pleura and the visceral pleura. So this is about the serous sac, and what you have to know in this is we have important features for this serous sac. Parietal layer is closely attached to the fibrous pericardium, whereas visceral layer is closely attached with the heart and its great vessels also. So there is a continuity between these two layers at the level of the two tubes. One tube is around the arch of aorta and the pulmonary trunk. Other tube is around the venous veins of the heart. Like we have four pulmonary veins are there, and superior vena cava, inferior vena cava. So around these six veins, you have one tube called as a venous tube, whereas another tube is around this arch of aorta and the pulmonary trunk. So we have an arterial tube is there and venous tube is there. At these areas, these two, pulmonary pericardium and the serous pericardium, they are continuous. Suppose I will trace this one, serous pericardium, I will start at the arch of aorta, right? Parietal pericardium, arch of aorta, it goes along with this fibrous pericardium, and it goes along with the fibrous pericardium below, you can observe here, and it goes into the posterior aspect of the heart here along with the fibrous pericardium, and it comes to the upper margin of the left atrium. There is, it is reflected backwards, and it becomes the, there it becomes the visceral pericardium, and it continues with the heart, and again continues with the heart anteriorly, and it joins the parietal pleura in front of the aorta and the pulmonary trunk. So this is how it is formed, the relation. So you know that here at the arch of aorta and the pulmonary trunk, this visceral pleura is visceral pericardium continues as the parietal pericardium. Same way at the level of the lower margin of the left atrium, you see that there is a continuity of the visceral and the parietal pericardium. Now the important features in these serous pericardium is you have two sinuses are present, that is the transverse sinus and the oblique sinus. So transverse sinus is a tubular passage behind the pulmonary trunk and the arch of aorta. So I am passing my fingers. So this is a transverse sinus between the two visceral pericardium. So this is intervisceral pericardium, pericardial space. This is a transverse passage. So the boundaries are in anteriorly you have the arch of aorta and pulmonary trunk. Behind you have the, you see this is a superior vena cava. Behind is superior vena cava. And above is division of the pulmonary trunk. You can see this is a pulmonary trunk divisions, left and the right side arteries. And below you have the upper margin of the left atrium. Upper margin of the left atrium. So these are the relations of the transverse sinus. This is formed developmentally because of the degeneration of the dorsal mesocardium. And the one side general pericardial cavity of one side can be connected to the other side through the transverse sinus. And coming to the other sinus, oblique sinus, that is a cul-de-sac behind the left atrium. This is the left atrium behind the heart. If you observe, I am passing my fingers here, so that the boundaries of this oblique sinus are on the right side, you will have the right pulmonary veins and the inferior vena cava, and on the left side two pulmonary veins, and above it is limited by the upper margin of the left atrium, and below it is open. So there are the relations of the oblique sinus. They are present around the six veins. It is an inverted sinus, J-shaped sinus, we say that, because it is forming around the veins behind the left atrium. So this is about the oblique sinus, and this is between the visceral pericardium and the parietal pericardium. See, this is between these two, visceral pericardium and the parietal pericardium. We have a relations here for this oblique sinus. Anteriorly you have the left atrium, and posteriorly you have the parietal layer of pericardium, and along with that is the fibrous pericardium. Above is, it is related with the upper margin of the left atrium. So this is a relation of the oblique sinus, that is it in between the serous and the parietal and the visceral layer of the pericardium, this oblique sinus. Whereas transverse sinus is intervisceral, because between the arch of aorta and the pulmonary trunk is one visceral layer, and superior vena cava is another visceral layer of the pericardium. So we have important features for this one. The transverse sinus is above the left atrium, whereas oblique sinus is below the left atrium. That means upper margin of the left atrium, above that is the transverse sinus, below that is the oblique sinus. So I want to show you the same thing here in the heart. So if you observe this, so these are the, this is the inferior vena cava, this is the superior vena cava, this is the arch of aorta, and this is pulmonary arteries here, two pulmonary arteries on either side, right and left here, and this is pulmonary veins, superior and inferior, and here on the right side, superior and inferior pulmonary veins are there. So this, you can see this reflection here, this is the place where oblique sinus is seen, whereas transverse sinus is here, because transverse sinus is behind the arch of aorta and the pulmonary trunk here at this area, and this is the upper margin of the left atrium. So this is the oblique sinus. You could see the boundaries here. This is the superior pulmonary vein and inferior pulmonary vein on the right side, whereas superior pulmonary vein and inferior pulmonary vein on the left side. I could pass a finger here. This is the oblique sinus, and this is the transverse sinus, you could see. And blood supply of the pericardium, fibrous pericardium and the parietal pericardium is supplied by the internal thoracic artery and the descending descending aorta. And venous drainage is also into the azygous vein, and the you have the internal thoracic vein. And nerve supply is by the phrenic nerve. Same way, you have the visceral pericardium, it is supplied by the, you have the coronary arteries, and venous drainage into the coronary sinus. Nerve supply is by the vagus nerve and the sympathetic nerve fibers. And development, if you observe, you have primitive heart tube is there, and primitive heart tube, it is having parts from above downwards, it is having dilatations called as the truncus arterios, bulbus cordis, and then primitive ventricle, primitive atrium, and then you have sinus venosus. You have two horns for the sinus venosus, right horn and left horn, and right, each horn will be having three veins, vital vein, umbilical vein and common cardinal vein. Whereas truncus arteriosus, it continued as the arterial end, and then it is having two parts like pulmonary trunk and arch of aorta, they are from the truncus arteriosus. During development, if you observe, this is the primitive heart tube, and in front of it you have the pericardial sac is there, and in front of it you have the septum transversum. So septum transversum will gives rise to the both diaphragm and the fibrous pericardium. So you have fibrous pericardium here, and this is a sac, pericardial sac, and this is a heart tube. Here this heart tube invaginates into the pericardial sac, so that pericardial sac is having outer parietal layer and inner visceral layer. Parietal layer fuses with the fibrous pericardium, and finally how it becomes is, and not only that, this endocardial heart tube, primitive heart tube, it enlarges, and it gives rise to a loop called as a bulboventricular loop. So how it forms is, if you observe the bulboventricular loop, if you observe like this way, and this bulboventricular loop, totally primitive heart tube is invaginated into the pericardial sac like this, so that pericardial sac, it covers the anterior side and lateral side of the primitive heart tube, whereas you have bulboventricular loop like this, this is bulbo ventricular loop. So this bulbo ventricular loop is having on the posterior aspect connected or suspended by the dorsal mesocardium. So in this dorsal mesocardium, afterward there is degeneration will be there, so that you'll have a sinus. So this, because of this degeneration, there is a hole here that is called a transverse sinus. This transverse sinus is passing or connected with one pericardial cavity to the other side, general pericardial cavity. So transverse sinus is behind the, is formed like this because of degeneration of the dorsal mesocardium. So this is about the pericardium.